Welcome to the Commentaries, a podcast series from TAN in which you'll learn how to read and understand history's greatest Catholic works from today's greatest Catholic scholars. In every series of the Commentaries, your expert host will be your personal guide to not just read the book, but to live the book, shining the light of its eternal truths into our modern darkness. Visit tancommentaries.com to get your copy of the book and to subscribe for access to all the great reading plans, new episodes, bonus content, and exclusive deals for listeners of the Commentaries.
Today is day 9, and we'll be covering chapter 6, part 1 in the TAN edition of the book, covering the trip to Rome of Little Flower. But before we jump into this timeless memoir and spiritual guide, let us begin with a short prayer composed by Saint Therese. It's called Do the Holy Face. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, Amen. O adorable face of Jesus, so a beauty which ravishes my heart, vouchsafe to impress on my soul thy divine likeness, so that it may not be possible for thee to look at thy spouse without beholding thyself. O my beloved, for love of thee, I am content not to see here on earth the sweetness of thy glance, nor to feel the ineffable kiss of thy sacred lips. But I beg of thee to inflame me with thy love, so that it may consume me quickly, and that soon Therese of the Holy Face may behold thy glorious face in heaven. In the name of the Father, and Son, and the Holy Ghost, Amen. Written under obedience, the story of the soul received universal demand about the spiritual trialhood of Saint Therese. And Pope Pius XI said that her biography brought great profit to souls. And I say because it kindles charity. Last time, we discussed the little flower approaching Mother Superior, Carmel, Lisieux, at the age of 15, and the Superior said, only until after you've reached 21, but she said that she could appeal to the bishop, and then she did appeal to the bishop, and his lordship gave no decision, but wanted the vicar general to go on pilgrimage with Louis and Therese, and we'll see what the results were from that. Today we're going to talk about how Therese is quickly ascending the levels of the interior life, and then a few stories in her pilgrimage to Rome about her youthful fervor. So let us begin. As I mentioned, Therese is quickly ascending the levels of the interior life. She speaks of vanities by saying this, Celine and I found ourselves mixing with members of the aristocracy. In fact, a pilgrimage seemed to be made up of them, but we were not impressed and looked upon their high-sounding titles as nothing more than the vapor of smoke found in Joel. The words of the Imitation, do not be solicitous for the shadow of a great name. Were not lost on me, and I realized that real nobility is in the soul, not in the name. So at her tender age, she's growing quickly in the spiritual life, and we can see at this point that she doesn't really have a problem with mortal sin, which is the purgative way, but she's definitely in the illuminative way, and maybe high up, because spiritual mystics say that as the soul moves up to the levels in interior life, God accelerates drawing them to himself. And in this illumination, she penetrates the reality of priestly sanctity. And I want to make a note, when I was little, when I was in my, around the age of reason, and right before I received my confirmation, my early teens, I thought all priests were just holy because I only saw them at Mass and at the church. But she said this, I met many saintly priests that month, but I found also help that in spite of being above angels by their supreme dignity, they were nonetheless men and still subject to human weakness. So she speaks of the priest she met while she was on pilgrimage, perhaps the priest she was with, the priest she saw in Rome, and in other circumstances. And so the point, my comment is, we get the priests and bishops we pray for. If we are holy and we beg God with true charity to give us holy shepherds, then he'll grant that prayer. And if there's enough of us doing that, and if we're not holy and we succumb to a bitterness, then we're going to get unholy clergy. And that's one of the greatest scourges to the church, is to receive unholy clergy. So I hope that you see how important it is to pray for the clergy. Don't ever say anything evil about them, but pray for them, because they need the prayers to have the lights to lead souls and shepherd souls. Then she soaks in the beauty of Switzerland's mountains in a train. She speaks about the scenery as it passes by, the snow-capped peaks lost in the clouds, the waterfalls, deep valleys, the rich giant ferns, and the purple heather. And she says this, "This profusion of nature's loveliness did so much good to my soul, raising it to the God who had poured such wonders on a land of exile destined to endure for but a day. At one moment, we were high up upon the mountainside with yawning chasms at our feet, ready to engulf us. At another, passing through a charming village with flimsy clouds lazily wandering over its chatlets and graceful spire. Then by a broad lake with calm, clear waters mingling with azure. With the crimson of the setting sun, I cannot say what an impression the magnificence and grandeur of these scenes made upon me. It was a foretaste of heaven's wonders. Then I thought of the religious life as it really is, with its restrictions and its little hidden sacrifices every day. And I saw how easily one might become so taken up with oneself that one might forget the glorious purpose of one's vocation. I thought to myself, later on in the hour of trial, when enclosed in Carmel, I shall only be able to see a little corner of the sky. I will look back on today and be encouraged. The thought of God's majesty and greatness will put my own small troubles in their place." So I comment on this because notice how she was engulfed in silence. There were no such things as radios and loudspeakers and televisions and phones going on around. She could really soak in nature, and she had a chance to savor that in her soul, speaking to God. Notice how she has a constant conversation with God. So the challenge for us today is to imitate her in this life of noisiness. And we can do that, dear soul. We can. We need to be in nature as much as possible. When the sun is rising and setting, make a point to go to your windows or to go outside and to see that. Not only is it good for us naturally, but it's really good for the soul. But look at how she's willing to sacrifice the short time she was in Carmel. She probably would not be able to see the horizon being enclosed in those walls that keep the silence away from the busy Lisieux. She had great foresight. And then finally, we come to her youthful fervor. First, we start with the House of Loreto. But before I quote from her, some of you may not know, but the House of Loreto is where the Blessed Virgin Mary received the Annunciation and accepted that Jesus be conceived in her womb. This house was miraculously lifted up and moved by angels to this farmland in Italy. I remember reading commentaries how farmers would see this floating house carried by angels, and they made comments about it, and it's recorded in history. So we enter into the scene here with that in mind. And before I quote her again, it was the Roman custom that Holy Communion was to be given out only from the altar that had the tabernacle. And so there were many altars in the church, but the tabernacle altar was one that was not inside the House of Loreto. Now, the House of Loreto, I've been there. It does have its own altar. So Therese and Celine, they hurried over when they found out that communion could only be received according to the Roman custom. They found this priest that was preparing for Mass, and they asked him if they could receive communion at his Mass, and he agreed to do that. And so Therese was able to receive communion in the very place where Mary received Jesus in her womb. And here's what Therese says. A priest with special dispensation was saying Mass there, and we told him what we wished so much to do. This considerate priest at once asked for two small hosts and placed them on the paten. You can guess what a joy that communion was, a joy beyond words. So what will an eternal communion be like in the house of the King of Heaven? The joy of that will never be concluded by the sadness of farewell. There will be no need to steal fragments from the walls which his presence sanctified, for his house will be all our own forever and ever. So Therese is just showing how she is having that constant conversation with God is becoming more and more intense, because her words speak so many beautiful truths contemplating what life will be in heaven. There will be no need to steal the fragments from the walls, because we will no longer need reminders of the reality that we believe by faith of the Annunciation and all the other mysteries of Jesus, our Redeemer, but we'll be in the very presence of God, face to face. And that's why St. Thomas says the beatific vision is the greatest gift God can give to us. So it's small wonder that St. Therese of the Little Child chose to be also called of the Holy Face, because she speaks so much about beholding him who loves us. And then we have her youthful fervor in the Colosseum. They went to the Colosseum in 1887 when she was about 14 or 15. And this was the arena of so many martyrs. But the arena was buried by earth by 26 feet down. And when she found this out, she stopped paying attention to the nurse, because she so much desired to find the very earth where the martyrs spilt their blood and to kiss that sanctifying ground. And so they found a way through. And this is what she said. We both ran forward at once, scrambling over the ruins, which crumbled under our feet, while Father shouted after us, astonished at our recklessness, but we did not hear. As warriors of old felt their courage grow in the face of danger, so our joy increased with our tiredness and the danger we faced to get to our longed-for goal. Celine, who was more far-sighted than I, had been listening to the guide, who was describing a small stone cross which marked the place where the martyrs had fought the good fight. So she began looking around for it, and it was not long before we were kneeling on the sacred spot. Our hearts united in the selfsame prayer. My heart beat violently as I pressed my lips to the dust, once reddened with the blood of the early Christians, and I asked the grace to be a martyr too for Jesus. At the bottom of my heart, I felt that I was heard. So we have this beautiful ending of our commentary in this episode. How, I wonder, the communion of the saints, how pleased they are to see such a childlike faith, the little flower, the little way, being greatly devoted to the child Jesus. We will continue to see how she matures in her life, where she will one day desire to have that pure love of suffering, not for the sake of gaining heaven, which is a good thing, but because God is good, because he's beautiful and true. And that brings us to the end of day 9 in our study of the story of a soul. Thank you so much for listening and for joining me on your journey to grow deeper in your spiritual life. Next time, we'll be discussing Chapter 6, Part 2, in which the little flower recounts the events of her visit with Pope Leo XIII and how her escape and her desire to leave the world was authentic. Until then, God bless.
This has been an episode of The Commentaries, a podcast brought to you by Tan. To follow the show, study more of the greatest Catholic classics, and to support the commentaries and other great free content from Tan, visit tancommentaries.com to subscribe and use coupon code COM25 to get 25% off your next order, including The Story of a Soul and countless more spiritual works to deepen your interior life and guide you to heaven.